Something came from Baltimore, Baltimore, Baltimore. Something came from Baltimore, Baltimore, Baltimore.
Welcome to Something Came from Baltimore. My name is Tom Gallagher, and I'll be your host tonight. Remember that Something Came from Baltimore is a jazz, blues, and R&B podcast and radio show. And it's not really about Baltimore. And tonight, we review the life and times of one of the biggest stars before the rock and roll era, Louis Jordan. I had the opportunity to speak with Marv Goldberg. He is a writer and a historian of music who has wrote and followed all the R&B acts from the 1940s to 1950s. And that is his specialty. He has a great website called Yesterday's Memories, Rhythm and Blues Party. It's a great resource center, and that's how I found him. I was looking at information about the Swallows and went right to his page and then fell in love with his work. I got him as a guest tonight. We dig in deep and review the music character of Louis Jordan. And before we get into the interview, let's listen to a sample of one of Louis Jordan's many, many hits. The song is called Run Joe.
To talk for me, they shall give me the third degree. When they take me before the judge, I am going to deny the charge. When the judge asks me how I plead, not guilty, sir, most decidedly. You can see, judge, at a glance, I am a victim of circumstance.
Run Joe!
Hey, the man at the door.
Run Joe!
The man won't let me go.
Run Joe!
Run Joe's
passing. So I love this. This is your notes on this. It's basically the story of Louis Jordan. Yeah.
I tried to summarize the whole thing, and I will read it, which will be somewhat boring in a way, but it will tell the story.
Yeah, tell the story.
Okay.
Yeah.
You ready to start?
Yeah, tell the story.
Okay. Louis Jordan was born on July 8th, 1908 in Arkansas. He was a son of Jim Jordan, who was a band leader and horn player. And Louis attended college in Little Rock to study music, becoming an alto sax player with occasional forays into tenor sax and clarinet. For some reason, alto sax players do turn up as clarinet players too. He came to New York, where he was asked by drummer Chick Webb to join a couple of Brunswick recording sessions in June 1929. That's how far back he goes. But the association didn't last, and Jordan returned to Little Rock, where he joined the Charlie Gaines Orchestra in 1932 and even got to record behind Louis Armstrong, who didn't have his own band at the time. The good thing about that association is that from Louis Armstrong, he learned that as well as appealing to Black audiences, he had to also appeal to white audiences. Most Black entertainers of the time appealed strictly to Black audiences. In 1934, he was on some vocalion recordings with the Clarence Williams Orchestra, and his first recorded vocal took place then with them. It was called I Can't Dance, I've Got Ants in My Pants. Cool title.
Mm-hmm.
In 1936, he once again became associated with Chick Webb, this time as a permanent member of his band playing alto sax. His vocals were heard as part of a trio with Ella Fitzgerald and Taft Jordan, until in 1937, January 37, he did his first solo vocal on Gee, But You're Swell. But there was no hint of the future Jordan in that one. However, he left Webb in 1938 because he wanted to be an all-round performer, and Webb only featured Ella Fitzgerald at that point, although Jordan was the band's announcer and was the alto sax player on her A Tisket, A Tasket hit. At that point, Jordan took over the Jesse Stone Band at the Elks Rendezvous in Harlem, and they became, without probably too much thought, the Elks Rendezvous Band. They got a contract with Decca Records and released Barnacle Bill the Sailor under that name in early 1939. However, from then on, the Jordan Band would always be known as the Tympany Five, regardless of the actual body count. Sometimes it was six, seven, eight members. They did Keep a Knockin', which was a fairly popular song at the time, Keep a Knockin', But You Can't Come In, But there were no Billboard charts in 1939, so I don't know if it was considered a hit.
And here is the 1947 Jack, You're Dead.
If you don't respond to romance, Jack, you're dead. When a chick is smiling at you, even though there's nothing said, if you stand there like a statue, Jack, you're dead. You've been always kicking, but you stubbed your toes when you ups and kicks the bucket, just like old man Moe's.
But the hits would come. I'm going to do something kind of boring now and read you a bunch of titles, because this is how many hits he had.
Yeah, go ahead.
See how many titles you actually know. These are the top 10 hits from Billboard from 1942 through 1945. Now, in those days, it wasn't called the Rhythm and Blues Charts. It was called the Race Charts, as opposed to the Pop Charts. A chicken ain't nothing but a bird. Remember, these are all top 10 hits. Do You Call That a Buddy? This is one of his betrayal songs, wherein he takes in somebody out of the goodness of his heart who then betrays him in some manner. Knock Me a Kiss. I'm going to move to the outskirts of town. I'm going to leave you at the outskirts of town. What's the Use of Getting Sober? This was a number one Billboard song. Five Guys Named Mo. Ration Blues, another number one Billboard song. It was also on the Pop Charts. G.I. Jive, another number one song. It was also number one on the Pop Charts. Is You Is or Is You Ain't My Baby, also on the Pop Charts. Mop Mop, number one song. You Can't Get That No More, also Pop. That was a World War II type song, talking about shortages. Caldonia, a number one song, also on the Pop Charts.
Walking with my baby, she got great big feet. She long, lean, and lanky, and they had nothing to eat. But she's my baby, and I love her just the same. Crazy about that woman, cause Caldonia is her name. Caldonia, Caldonia, what makes your big head so hard? I love you just the same. I'll always love you, baby, cause Caldonia is your name.
Somebody Done Changed the Lock on My Door. My Baby Said Yes, a duet with Bing Crosby. This was only on the Pop Charts. Now we come to the top 10 hits in 1946, at which point big bands were on the way out and the music scene was ripe for small combos like Jordan's. Buzz Me, number one song, also on the Pop Charts. Don't Worry About That Mule. Salt Pork, West Virginia, Reconversion Blues. Beware, this is one of those, a talk to the audience song, also on the Pop Charts. In this one, he's telling men to beware of women for various reasons. Don't Let the Sun Catch You Crying. Stone Cold Dead in the Market, a number one tune, with Ella Fitzgerald, also made the Pop Charts. Patootie Pie, another duet with Ella Fitzgerald. Choo Choo Chaboogie, this one spent 18 weeks at number one on the Race Charts. It also made the Pop Charts.
Heading for the station with a pack on my back. I'm tired of transportation in the back of a hack. I love to hear the rhythm of the clickety-clack and hear the lonesome whistle, see the smoke from the stack. And pal around with Democratic fellas named Mac. So take me right back to the track, Jack. Choo-choo, choo-choo, jaboogie. Woo-woo, woo-woo, jaboogie. Choo-choo, choo-choo, jaboogie. Take me right back to the track, Jack.
That Chick's Too Young to Fry, Ain't That Just Like a Woman, number one on the R&B chart, well, the Race Charts, also on the Pop Charts. Ain't Nobody Here But Us Chickens, spent 17 weeks at number one, also on the Pop Charts.
And here is the 1956, Ain't Nobody Here But Us Chickens.
Chicken up an awful fuss. We chickens trying to sleep, and you bust in, and hobble, 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 it's a sin. Tomorrow is a busy day. We got things to do, we got eggs to lay, we got ground to dig and worms to scratch. It takes a lot of
setting, getting chicks to hatch. There ain't nobody here but us chickens. There ain't nobody here at all. So quiet yourself.
Let the good times roll. Note that in 1946, Jordan was switched over to Decca's pop series. And in that year, the only Decca artist that outsold Louis Jordan was Bing Crosby. Here is top 10 hits in 1947. Texas and Pacific, number one, also on the pop charts. Open the Door, Richard. There was so much competition, this one almost only made number two, but it was also on the pop charts. Jack, You're Dead, number one, also on the pop charts. I Like 'Em Fat Like That, I Know What You're Putting Down. Boogie Woogie, Blue Plate, 14 weeks at number one, also on the pop charts. Look Out, another Talk to the Audience song. On this one, he apologized for Beware and tells women what to look out for in men. Mm-hmm. And finally, Early in the Morning.
Right, had a little date with my baby last night. Now it's early in the morning, early in the morning, early in the morning, and I ain't got nothing but the blues. I went to all the places.
In 1948, he had some top 10 hits: Barnyard Boogie, How Long Must I Wait for You, Reek Petit and Gone, Run Joe, a number one tune, also on pop, Don't Burn the Candle at Both Ends, and Daddy-O, a duet with Martha Davis, and also Pettin' and Pokin'. The hits are getting fewer now. In 1949, Roman Blues, You Broke Your Promise, Coleslaw, Every Man to His Own Profession, Baby It's Cold Outside, duet with Ella Fitzgerald, also pop, Beans and Cornbread in number one, Saturday Night Fish Fry, 12 weeks at number one, also pop.
From 1966, it's the TV show called The Beat. There's a live version of the Saturday Night Fish Fry.
You don't have to pay to use the admission if you cook part of the waiter or the good musician. So if you have to be just passing by, stopping at Saturday Night Fish Fry, one rocket.
After that, there were only sporadic hits. Blue Light Boogie was number one in 1950. His last chart record was Weak Minded Blues from May 1941. However, he did continue to remain popular at live shows. It's worth noting that the A&R man at Decca for most of Jordan's hits was Milt Gabler, whose touch you can also hear on Bill Haley's hits for Decca later on. Louis Jordan was in some movies, Follow the Boys and Meet Miss Bobby Sox, both in 1944, Caldonia 1945, Swing Parade of 1946, Swing Time Jamboree and Beware, all from 1946, Look Out Sister and Reek Petit and Gone from 1947. There were also several soundies. These were 1940s music videos that played on a special machine that was found in barbershops, beauty parlors, railroad stations, and lots of bands were seen in these soundies. He did Fuzzy Wuzzy, Five Guys Named Mo, G.I. Jive, and I'm going to Move to the Outskirts of Town. He also recorded several AFRS Jubilee records and V-discs. These were special recordings made for G.I.s. They were either broadcast over Armed Forces Radio or mailed overseas to fighting GIs. And you know that Jordan was a big star because his Is You Is or Is You Ain't made it to a Tom and Jerry cartoon where Tom the Cat is singing.
I got a gal always late, anytime we have a date, but I love her, I'm gonna ask her, Is You Is or Is You Ain't, my baby. The way you acting lately makes me down. You is still my baby, baby. See my flame in your heart's done go now. A woman is a creature that's always been strange. Just when you sure of one, you find she's gone and made a change. Maybe baby's found somebody new. My little day though, Didi, my baby's still my baby true.
However, by 1950, his sound, which was called urban blues and jump blues, was being pushed aside by the nascent R&B. Decca would drop him in late 1953, at which time he switched over to Aladdin Records. While he had some good recordings at Aladdin, like Whiskey Do Your Stuff, Dad Gum Your High Boy, Yeah You Need a Whippin', and I Seen What You Done, none of them charted. After that, it was X and Vic, two RCA subsidiaries, where he tried to reinvent himself as a creator of rock and roll. It didn't work. His style had gone out of fashion. After Vic, he had a lot of releases on Mercury, but many of them were just remakes of his Decca hits and, again, didn't sell.
From 1946, let's listen to Let the Good Times Roll.
Other labels after that, lots of other labels, but nothing worked. The only song I remember ever hearing by Louis Jordan on the radio while it was current was something called Hard Head from 1963, which is on Ray Charles's Tangerine label. Louis Jordan was a performer with a capital P and an entertainer with a capital E. He was one of the few 1940s black artists that crossed over into the white market consistently, along with the Inkspots and Bill's brother, Ella Fitzgerald. But by the time he died in Los Angeles in 1975, he was pretty much unknown by anyone who wasn't buying records in the 1940s and forgotten by most of them. Just to illustrate how he was both remembered and forgotten, in 1992, a review called Five Guys Named Mo, only featuring Louis Jordan's music, played 445 performances on Broadway. I did not see it, so I can't tell you what the playbill said. However, I did see it a couple of years later in an off-Broadway theater on Long Island, and the playbill never even mentioned Jordan's name. I complained to the box office. I'm sure they did nothing about it. Anyway, that's what I have to say about Louis Jordan.
Wow. Yeah, I thank you very much for talking about Louis Jordan. In some ways, I feel like his legacy gets weakened through the years where he's not mentioned as a pioneer as he should be. Joe Jackson, Chuck Berry, James Brown, Little Richard, Ray Charles, B.B. King, George Clinton, Dr. John, they all use him as an influence, a major influence.
Oh, I'm sure lots and lots of entertainers used him as a role model, but they probably didn't mention it much later on. The only performer that I would equate with Louis Jordan is Cab Calloway. I mean, he was somebody who got up on stage and owned it. Louis Jordan got up on stage and owned it. I'm sure there were others, but these are the ones that I would put at the top of the heap.
I think the soundies really helped him for at least how dynamic he was and how infectious his music is. When people fade out like that, you have something that you can refer back to.
Yeah, well, you see it in his movies, you see it in the soundies. So many performers who were probably really, really good have no visual record left. So you'll never know what they were like in person, which was really what counted.
And here's another song called GI Jive.
PFC, the CPL, the SGT, the LT, CP, the OD, the MP makes you do cappy. It's a GI jive, man alive. It starts with a bugler blowing reveille over your bed when you arrive. Hey, Jack, that's a GI jive. Rootily toot, jump in your suit, make a salute. Arrivoot, after you wash and dress, more or less, you go get your breakfast from a beautiful little cafe they call the mess. Hey, Jack, when you convalesce, out of your seat, into the street, make with your feet, or read, if you're a PVT,
So he had now astounding 18 number ones, which I went through and I was like, okay, in the pop charts. Now, these charts are ranked differently. There's only three people in the pop world that has had 18 or more, which is Elvis, Mariah Carey, and the Beatles. When it comes to R&B, there's only three artists that had more than him, which was Drake, Aretha Franklin, and Stevie Wonder.
I've heard of them.
18 number ones and number one for 113 weeks in his career, which is 2 years, 2 months, and one week. That's insane. He had five number ones in a row that they just bumped each other off. And that was a record for 44 weeks. That is amazing. Like most of his stuff, if you listen to it now, there are different versions. There's the original, and then he later in life went back and re-recorded everything. And I think he was trying maybe for a bluesier vibe with some of the stuff.
Well, again, it was, hey, I'm the guy who created rock and roll, so I'm going to show you what I did type thing. But truly, if you want to know Louis Jordan, listen to the deck of stuff.
The reason that he didn't hit rock and roll is what they're saying is that it was a youth market. His stuff is just as good as Rock Around the Clock or any of that stuff. He never left his mark. I mean, maybe his stuff wasn't as witty or as interesting, maybe, but the sound would fit in that time period. It's just a matter of he was an old man. And they were like, this is a youth culture, and we're going to really capitalize on teens, and we're going to focus on young artists. And he just seemed like an older dude compared to what was out there.
Well, again, when you go and record for a record company, you really have almost no control over what they did. So when he's recording for Mercury, whose idea was it to re-record his old stuff? Was it theirs? Was it his? And who did they push it to? Did they push it to the older people, nostalgia market, or did they try to get the young people involved? I don't know.
It's a shame. It seems that he had a tax issue at the end. He put a lot of his writing credits, because his songs are amazing, in one of his wife's names. So he kind of really, I guess, left this earth very faded and uncelebrated the way that he should have been.
Well, speaking of his wife, one of his wives anyway, Fleecy, whom he put several songs in her name, she tried to get him to leave this earth a lot earlier. She stabbed him a few times. I think it was 1947. I guess she didn't like him much.
And one thing about the Chick Webb thing, just because I noticed, when he left Chick Webb, that was kind of the time period that Chick Webb was getting very ill and wasn't touring as much. So it sounds like, you know, he needed to go to that next level and say, okay, I got enough following that I can kind of go on my own.
I don't really know. I haven't followed Chick Webb, but I think he got out because he wanted to be more than just the announcer for the band and the sax player. That was the real problem. Chick Webb was so enamored of Ella Fitzgerald, whom he adopted, that he didn't want to leave room for anybody else to do much. Now, like I tell you, he was a good singer, and he was an excellent entertainer. He was also a good sax player. I read somewhere that some guy in the orchestra couldn't believe how quickly he could go from singing to instantly playing the sax and back again. You know, there was no breath taken.
I'll tell you a story from way back. Truck on down to Digger Jack. This big mo, do you not, little mo, do you not, four eye mo, do you not, no mo, do you not, look at brother, look at brother.
So as a young guy, how I heard about him was through Joe Jackson. Joe Jackson in 1981 did this Jump and Jive album, just songs that he liked as a child. And I was like, oh, this is great. And then that made me do a little research on him. And I was also falling in love with James Brown. And I was like, wow, these songs are great. Caledonia and Ain't Nobody Here But Us Chickens. I thought that they were James Brown songs initially. And then when I did the research, I was like, oh, this guy has a stockpile of amazing songs.
Well, this is what he heard as a child on the radio in his house. Possibly his parents had a record player and they bought the records too. A lot of the race records were not purchased. Sales were not all that high because most black families didn't have a record player. So they mostly heard them on jukeboxes and off the radio.
So one of the questions I had is that since the race chart was in its infancy and the way that they track hits back then.
Well, they had different kind of charts and they did have jukebox plays because there were counters in the jukeboxes. So they knew what was being played. Actually, I have no idea.
Yeah. I'd
like to think it was sales of records, but also disc jockey spins. They had charts for that also.
And here's that big hit from 1940. It's You Run Your Mouth and I'll Run My Business.
You cats keep beating up your chops. I ought to turn you over to the cops. But dig this spiel, I'm gonna lay on your gate. Don't cop your broom, park the body and wait. You run your mouth and I run my business, brother. You run your mouth and I run my business, brother. You tell everybody I'm busted. You talk so much you got me disgusted. But you run your mouth and I run my business, brother. You run your mouth and I run my business, brother. You run your mouth and I run my business, brother. You start in telling me you're my pal and end up telling me how to handle my gal. You run your mouth and I run my business, brother. You run your juicy mouth and I run my business, brother.
I appreciate you talking to me today. Something came from Baltimore.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, I love it. I hope you enjoyed today's episode of Something Came from Baltimore. Please subscribe and share the podcast to your friends and family. We all want you to be a part of that Be More Music scene.
Just clap your liver lips and I run my business, brother. Clap your liver lips and I run my business, brother. If I'd followed your advice on how to make dough, I'd been in the jailhouse long ago. You run your mouth and I run my business, brother.